Hello, my name is Jermaine Sacco, and I'm president of the Diversity Alliance and the Multicultural Ambassador. Our 2020 MLK Jr. celebration speaker is Dr. Eddie Moore Jr. Dr. Eddie Moore Jr. has pursued and achieved success in academics, business, diversity, leadership, and community service. In 1996, he started American Moore LLC to provide comprehensive diversity, privilege, leadership, and becoming anti-racist trainings workshop. He is recognized as one of the nation's top speakers and educators. His interview with Wisconsin Public Radio won the 2015 Wisconsin Broadcasters Association Best Interview in Media Market Radio first place. He's featured in the film, I Am Not Racist, Am I? And in the article, 5 Clear Ways to Tell Whether You Are a Good Leader in 2021. Dr. Moore was recently named one of Wisconsin's 51 most influential black leaders, and he is also the founder slash program director for the Global White Privilege Conference, WPC. In 2014, Dr. Moore founded the Privilege Institute, TPI, which engages people in research, education, action, and leadership through workshops, conferences, publications, and strategic partnerships and relationships. He is co-founder of the online journal Understanding and Dismantling Privilege, co-editor of Everyday White People Confront Racial and Social Injustice, 15 Stories, The Guide for White Women Who Teach Black Boys, The Diversity Consult Cookbook, Preparing for the Challenge, 2019, Teaching Beautiful, Brilliant Black Girls, forthcoming 2021, and The Big Misunderstanding, 2020. For 10 years, he served as Director of Diversity at Brooklyn Friends School in Brooklyn, New York, and the Bush School in Seattle, Washington. Dr. Moore received his PhD from the University of Iowa in Education Leadership. His PhD research is on black football players at Division III schools in the Midwest. It is a pleasure to have you with us today, Dr. Moore. Please give a warm welcome to Dr. Eddie Moore.
I like it. Right. All right, I love watching those future leaders in action. Meeting future presidents, senators, doctors, lawyers. So good to be able to say, I knew you win. Y'all was representing. The president should be proud. And I appreciate the president being here, not just doing the introduction. That is really important, because I've been to a lot of places where there's been an appearance by the leadership. And I appreciate the prayers hanging out with us a little bit. Now, I'm from the black church. Y'all talk back to folks? Yeah. All right, y'all, we're going to have a little talk back today about MLK. Because I don't know if we still should be dreaming. I mean, 2022. Are we making progress? Are we doing better? Are we moving forward? I mean, this is what I really want to be in conversation with y'all about here today. Why keep dreaming? What is it that we should be doing as we look ahead over these next 25 years? As you think about being a president or a CEO or being a lawyer or a doc, wherever it is you want to be in the next 10, 15 years. I mean, now is our time. I mean, I don't know if any of you have seen any of the footage from those days. Some days I'm thankful I wasn't experiencing that kind of hate. I don't know. I'd like to say I could stand tall. I could do it. I'll be honest with you, GVU, I don't know. But I think right now, I'm ready. This is what I want us to be thinking about as we're in conversation, and hopefully for the next 364 days after this, we're doing some other things in reference to MLK that is not just this day. And so I'm going to have us hopefully doing some reflecting and maybe have a little time to have some talk back. But let's start by remembering some of the social justice giants that we've lost recently. Names like John Lewis, Cicely Tyson, Hank Aaron, Ruth Bader Ginsburg, Lonnie Vanier, Sidney Poitier, Desmond Tutu, Bell Hooks. And one of my most influential friends and colleagues, the late, great Dr. Jim Lorne, who wrote the book Lies Our Teachers Told Us. Lies My Teacher Told Me, our Sundown Towns, and many other great texts. This brother taught me so much and really spent a lot of time in Mississippi. As a white man with a PhD from Harvard, he went to Mississippi and really put some effort and energy in doing some work in that area and has really, again, as I said, impacted me in so many ways, past, present, future. This is one of the people, one of the giants I stand on personally. RIP, my good brother, Jim Lorne. Secondly, how y'all doing? My goodness. We've had the pandemic. Y'all all right? I mean, I know you said 2020, I was confused by the Olympics, you know what I'm saying? It was like 2020 and it was 2021. I was confused by the census. It was like 2020 and it was 2021. I mean, we've been through a lot, y'all. How y'all doing? I think it's worth checking in on one another because there's been a lot going on. Now, I don't know about y'all, but I haven't been the greatest in my past of expressing my emotions outwardly, and I'll confess to that in front of y'all. But I think this is a time where we've been through a lot. I mean, I think we should be thanking our ancestors. I don't know about y'all, but I'm looking back at my grandma, my ancestors whom I don't even know that endured some of the most horrific crimes a human being could ever experience, even right here in this great nation, and responded with love. I feel like I'm wired that way. Like I can experience a racist incident, a oppressive incident, and my response is love. But I tell you, these last couple years, it's been, whew, Prez, it's been tough at times. Been tough at times. I had to check myself up a little bit. I mean, you think about it. We've seen, like I said, pandemic. We've seen white supremacy, violence. We've seen anti-immigration hate, anti-Asian hate, anti-black hate. I mean, we've seen a police killing, the most horrific, one of the most horrific killings of a human being live on TV. The insurrection, live. We've had guilty verdicts around some of these crimes. We've had not guilty verdicts, live on TV. And in the work I do around some of the anti-CRT movements that are going on around there, there's some discussions, some agreements, some disagreements, but I mean, in some places, it feels like the legacy of black people is being asked to be removed from school buildings because of the discomfort that it causes. Like, people like, okay, possibly, because this was not a person loved at the time of life. In fact, the latest reports at the time of his death showed a 75% of America disapprove of MLK. Ah, don't know. Y'all all right? I don't know. I'm reminded, as I reflect on all of that, that justice is hard work. Love is hard work. I mean, I can't imagine being in the time of MLK, civil rights movement, turning the other cheek. Whew, that's some hard work. I mean, we were just, before you came in, Press, some of us were listening a little bit to the I Have a Dream speech. I hope y'all get a chance to listen to it in its entirety. 16 minutes, 23 seconds, that's all it is. That's all it is. I recommend that every American spend at least one day spending 16 minutes and 23 seconds listening. Even if you agree and disagree with everything and all the things that are going on around diversity and all that kind of stuff, because we wouldn't have some of the relationships, some of the opportunities, some of the workplace environments, some of the, I mean, the statistics you're quoting about the university in reference to small private college being the most diverse. I mean, that's not happening without 16 minutes and 23 seconds. So at least take one day of your life and give 16 minutes and 23 seconds, because I say those 16 minutes, 23 seconds have impacted the rest of my life. So I would encourage you, just take a few minutes to just listen. But as we were listening, y'all, I was wondering, like, is this speech relevant today? You know, the footage is old. I don't know if y'all seen it. If you actually get a chance to watch it, I mean, it's some old footage. 1962, 63. Is that speech relevant today? Is it applicable to what we're doing today? Back to my question earlier. I mean, have we progressed from that time? Are we getting better? Are we moving the needle? How much? What's next? As you look at the next 25 years of your life, are you optimistic about justice, about equity? As I was reflecting these last few weeks, getting ready for my couple weeks of MLK presenting and conversations, three things I thought about. Number one, Childish Gambino. Y'all remember that song, This Is America? I mean, what is it? What, I mean, if you say we're progressing, I mean, you gotta know the facts. That's one thing Jim Lowen taught me as a scholar. You gotta know the facts. So if things are getting better, give me a sense of what you think better looks like, okay? Now, in my research, when I look at all the key life indicators, the things that determine whether our lives are better, okay? Since 1963-64, the research is showing those gaps that existed at the time, and what the time which King was challenging, pushing, asking for America to come to grips with the promissory note, what it had promised it, black folks in America. He was challenging America to come to grips with what was owed. And so here we are, 2022. The research shows the gaps are wider. I was gonna say wider, but wider. The gaps are widening, some would say. I mean, this is what we gotta think about. This is what I want y'all to think about the next 25 years. I'm not here to rain on. I mean, I hope you ain't come to MLK for sunshine and mushrooms and poppy troll. I mean, it's MLK. It's the civil rights movement. I think we gotta be remembering, we gotta be reminded of what was at stake at that time, what people were going through. And if we're gonna really stand here now and say, hey, things are better, we're there, we're progressing, I mean, let's get a sense of what we're talking about here then. And Dr. King, when he was talking to the public, was pushing them. It wasn't a kumbaya, let's hold hands, sing I mean, there was some of that, but he was pushing all audience, folks of color and white folks, to do better. So if we're going to do better, we're going to have a sense of where we are. And the research is showing not only are there gaps, but they're widening. If you look at education gaps, guess what? Wider. If you look at employment gaps, guess what? Wider. You look at healthcare gaps, guess what? Wider. Income gaps, guess what? Wider. Incarceration gaps, guess what? Wider. Home ownership gaps, one of the number one ways to build wealth, build capital in America, guess what? Wider. Technology gaps, guess what? Wealth gaps, guess what? I remember when people used to say when I was growing up, early days, college, graduate school, the rich are getting richer. The poor are getting
poorer.
Is that still true today?
It's been true for a while.
Where is the progress? What is it that we're focused on? What is it that we're trying to do as we look at the next 25 years? I'm not here to blame a group. I'm not here to shame a group. I'm saying as a collective, when we look at doing better, if we can be an acknowledgement, which we have to be. I mean, we're sitting here in this beautiful university, this beautiful auditorium. I mean, I'm dressed to the nine, PhD black man from the neighborhood. Come on now. I'm not standing here saying that there hasn't been no movement. That'd be ridiculous. That's ludicrous. Get out the way. Oh, sorry. Just a little DJ flashback there. Sorry. I mean, seriously, that would be ridiculous. If you're having conversation with people and they're talking about nothing is... Run, Forrest, run. Nah. I can't roll like that. I'm okay being harsh, being tough and grading and assessing and evaluating where we are, but to say nothing? Come on. But this is for y'all. This is for you. The president getting ready to ride off into the sunshine. Maxing and relaxing. Maxing and doggone it, he's earned it. I hope in the next 10, 15 years to get me one of those cars too off into the sunset. I'm talking to you. 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 The next 25 years. Are we going to come back here and be dealing with wider? This is where I want you to be thinking and considering as you look ahead, as you think about the world you want to live in, you want to participate in. I mean, this is ridiculous. And if you want to get a little deeper into Iowa, I left you some links right there. I'll send this presentation to you if you email me. I only share my work if there's effort put in to receive it. Now, if you email me, I'll send it to you. And I want this to be a challenge to y'all to think about the next 25 years. Are we going to return back and the gaps are wider under your watch, under your leadership? That's what I want us to be thinking about. That's what I want you to be thinking about. So the first thing is, is this the America we want? That's what Gambino, I think, is asking us, reminding us. That's what I'm asking you. That's what I'm reminding you to think about over these next 25 years. That's what I've been reflecting on as I've been listening to Dr. King, I Have a Dream, and some of the other things that are playing around his work, the history of his work. I've been asking myself, progress. Progress. Second thing is pancakes. Y'all like pancakes? Well, these pancakes are a little different. Have you ever met somebody in 2022 who still thinks like it's 1922? You ever meet people and you think, how did you get into the general population still thinking this way? I mean, they've never tried anything new. They've never read anything new. They've never explored anything. I mean, just 1922. That's the kind of pancakes I'm talking about. Resistance. Some would argue that the resistance that we're facing today and that you'll face over these next 25 years is going to be stronger and bolder. Like, people are going to be more out in front. You know what I'm saying? Y'all heard this before? Y'all seeing this? The resistance is going to be stronger and bolder. That's what I'm talking about when I talk about pancakes. I mean, that's what amazes me the most about MLK, the civil rights movement. I mean, they faced some nasty pancakes, you know what I'm saying? They faced some nasty resistance, you know what I'm saying? I mean, this is what I was talking about. Could I stand that strong? Could I be that patient? Could I be that positive? Could I offer this kind of love? Y'all heard that thing? Turn the other cheek. Y'all know what I'm saying? Woo! I mean, this is one of the most amazing things about the civil rights. Martin Luther King, that movement for me is the love in the midst of this kind of nastiness. I mean, just think back to those days. Just think about this. Like, day after day, week after week. I mean, some of these people were your age, experiencing some of this, participating in some of this. I mean, can you imagine frequently facing those angry mobs fueled with hate, white supremacy, anti-blackness? And your response, I love pancakes. Love that neighbor. Woo! That's an amazing feet. Now, Rev, I had to put a little Bible in the presentation because it is Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Y'all know that, right? Okay, great. Yeah, all right. I mean, I'm just glad we know. I mean, this is one of the toughest ones. I remember hearing this as a kid, still trying to live by Luke 27:28, chapter 6. Woo, just try it for a year. Try it for a year. The year has already started, but just try this. Try it for the rest of the month. Love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who... I just don't know. I mean, King talked about the sickness of segregation, of white supremacy ideology, back in the 60s. Now is our time. Some would argue we're seeing some flares of this kind of hatred, white supremacy, in today's society. Some people say those pancakes are still here. Thinking out there, hiring out there, promoting out there, leading out there, teaching out there, parenting out there, praying out there, preaching out there. In 2022, like it's 1922. What do you do with the pancakes that never flip over? That's what my family's taught me. That's what world travel, that's what America's taught me often. There are some pancakes that'll never flip over. No matter what you say, no matter what you do, they're gonna stay laser focused. Segregation yesterday, segregation today, segregation forever. Woo. Rev, I just don't know. I just don't know. Good thing that was a thing of the past. It's not that bad today, right? I mean, I don't know about y'all. I don't know. Maybe it's a dramatic jump. Maybe? Dramatic leap? Dramatically? Now, this follow me here. Now, this is really where it is important for us to think about. Again, love thy neighbor. I mean, this is just a small example, a small sample where people saw their neighbors, their community members, maybe even their family members participating in this kind of endeavor. I mean, everyday people like bus drivers and administrators and teachers and coaches and parents and classmates and lawyers and athletes and bankers and accountants and even dog owners. 2022 behaving like 1962. The question is, can we sustain the love of the civil rights movement, of MLK? Because this is our time now. I think this is, maybe I'm asking y'all because I'm asking me, because I mean, I don't know. I tell you, Perez, I was watching this, I was thinking, I wasn't showing a lot of MLK. I'll just be honest with y'all. I've had to check myself up. Now, maybe it's fizzled and sizzled and gone away. I don't know. But just my experience is, you know, there's still some of that out there. The challenge for us as we look at these next 25 years is sustaining the love. I think it's an important time for us to be thinking about self-care, and love that neighbor. 2022. Later, I want to hear from y'all just some of the things you're doing to face the resistance that you're facing today. Let me get to the end, because I want to see if y'all got some questions, some conversation. I want to get to the end and share with you my third point. My first point is, this is America. Second point is pancakes. Woo, you love pancakes, right? Woo. Y'all know the pancakes I'm talking about now. Sometimes it can be a challenge for me. But you better be ready. If you're going to do the work of justice, of equity, of community, of family, over these next 25 years, there are gonna be some pancakes in the mix. And I'm asking us to remember one of the most amazing feats of MLK, the civil rights movement, was love thy neighbor. Luke 6, 27, 28. And I'm telling y'all that because I'm still struggling with that. But it's just real for us, for y'all, I'm hoping to consider as we look ahead. One last thing is, I mean, we just got to do something. Sometimes people are so paralyzed, so hesitant because they don't know what to do. We got to do something. Action is important. That's the third thing I pull from watching MLK, watching the civil rights movement, and preparing for these next couple of weeks of talks and interaction and conversations with folks is just how weekly, I mean, the organized, I mean, it's just, I mean, and these were like high school kids, like college kids. It was just amazing. It's amazing if you ever get a chance to watch what it takes to put on these kinds of marches in reference to what they were doing during this time. If you ever watch any of that footage, it's amazing. It's amazing. To think about, these were like kids your age preparing, knowing what they're gonna endure, and preparing to endure, and supporting each other afterwards, caring for each other afterwards. Now, We're not going to have to endure any of that today, right? Next 25 years, right? I want to talk to y'all a little bit about Bell Hooks, what she's mentioning here in this concept of action, what we do. They say in my neighborhood, don't talk about it. Who said that? Whew. Somebody from neighborhood over there. What up, bro? I feel you over there. Yeah, don't talk about it. You got to be about it. Action, okay? Now, lots of people are good about identifying the problems, venting, but not so good about following up, taking action. So I invented a new term. I combined the two terms, vaction. That means you identify the problem. You could say what's wrong, but you're going to follow it up with action, right? I think this is where we are right now as a country. I mean, think about it. Grandview University, think about it. I mean, I don't know if you quite heard what the brother said. The most diverse private college in Iowa. I mean, that's where we are right now. Is places where I don't know if y'all quite envision this happening here at Grandview, but I'm not saying that was possibly something I was thinking was gonna happen at Grandview. You know, I was thinking maybe, I don't know, Grinnell. You know what I'm saying? You feel me? Right? Think about that. This is where we are right now. Right here, this fine liberal arts private school in Des Moines, Iowa. Leading the state in the pursuit of diversity and inclusion. The presence of diversity. That's monumental. You're to be applauded for that. That's huge. That's where we are. I mean, everybody's trying. Everybody's pursuing. It feels like, and it's really exciting, to feel like there's a real concentrated effort to bring diversity into organizations, into corporations, into university, into school buildings. That's great. Simultaneously, alongside of that, you have white supremacy. White supremacists on the rise, according to the research that's coming out. We're seeing, some folks may even attest to this, we're seeing folks being a lot more bolder in their expression of anti-immigration, anti-Asian, anti-black. You feel me? How do those two things coexist? Over the next 25 years, this is, I think, is the challenge for this generation. It's really finding some solutions, finding some answers to the rise, the greatest amount of diversity our nation has ever seen. That's what the 2020 census has shown, that America now is more diverse than it's ever been. And guess what? The train's not turning around. That diversity is not just black and white, which makes it even more interesting. It's multicultural. We're seeing different kinds of families in combination, in connection, than we've ever seen in our great nation. That's what's happening right now. Simultaneously, we're seeing white supremacists, white extremists, white supremacist groups, hate groups on the rise. Can you attend Grandview University if you're a white supremacist? Could I be in your classroom? Could I be on your football team, your basketball team, your baseball team, your tennis team, your golf team? Could I be in your student club, your ambassador club, student government, Could I be on the staff? While simultaneously, you're the most diverse place, space, privately in the state. I think it's just an interesting dynamic to think about. I mean, I don't know. I'm trying to work on some kind of assessment tool to determine kind of where people are around some of those ideologies. Not to say that they should be fired right away. I mean, I think that's something the university, the college has to think about. The university has to think about. Do they belong here? Can they exist? Can they coexist? Can those things coexist? This is what I think is interesting. This is what I'm feeling like is a really interesting horizon over these next 25 years. America's changing. The world is changing. The question is, are we changing? Are your skills able to be successful, to be productive, to be healthy in that kind of environment? Should we even allow folks in these kinds of environments? What if they're in the leadership role? I think these are the kind of questions I'm putting out there, thinking that we're gonna have to be grappling with, that you're gonna have to be grappling with over the next 25 years. As some people are demanding even more access, even more diversity, even more anti-racist. Is Grandview University an anti-racist university? Are you committed to anti-racism as a university? I mean, some people are making that shift and thinking about what that is and what and how that factors in of the different. I mean, this is what, when you think about, we're a long ways from 1963, y'all. I mean, it's nice to hear the speech and fan up a little good feeling about MLK, one of the greatest heroes to contribute to America, but this is us. Now is our time. What are we thinking about? What are we building? What are we committed to over these next 25 years? This is what I think we should be considering during these times. Now is our time. The social justice choir. We need new songs, new ideas, new members, maybe singing another language every now and then. I mean, I know there's some pancakes out there we can't flip over. I'm not giving them all my energy. I'm talking to the choir, folks that want to be here. You had no reason to show up here today. There's no penalty if you're not here, and you chose to be here. So as a choir, what are we thinking about? How are we thinking about these next 25 years? Let me give you a couple things I want to add for you to consider as part of your vaction. Your action moving forward as you face some difficulties, some challenges. Okay? Remember this. Integration without preparation does not work. Okay? So if you bring in diversity and you're not preparing people at the place where the diversity is showing up in greater numbers than it's ever shown up, it is a recipe for disaster. Now, that disaster doesn't have to be, you know, some kind of insurrection incident. I'm not saying that. But often what we see is the students of color, the group, that diversity group, not being amplified, not giving, not reaching their full potential. And this is not just across race. This could be across gender. It could be across gender identity. You can't integrate if you don't prepare for that. That makes sense. All right. Sometimes I wonder if some people haven't got the memo that Jim Crow is dead. Like, we don't have to live in segregated environment. Now, my greatest test for the university, now that you're the leaders of diversity in the private school industry, is when I go in the cafeteria, does it look like 2022 or 1962? Because sometimes, even though there's an appearance of diversity, people are still practicing segregation. That's my challenge, Mr. President, to push to really not only have the appearance of diversity, but to actually be participating. That makes sense? Okay. America's changing. Just because you have diversity doesn't mean you're living diversity. America's changing. There's always been the presence of diversity in some places, but a lot of times, like big cities, Chicago, New York, I mean, some of the research on some of these cities shows they're the most segregated places in our nation, even though they have the greatest amount of diversity. That makes sense? That's the challenge for the university. President. Not off, do I get two presidents right in the front row there? Future president on the side right there, ready to roll. All right? You know what I'm saying? You feel me now? Y'all with me on this? And this is not just white folks who need work on integration skills. Now, I don't know about y'all, but I came from a black space. You know what I'm saying? Where I grew up, it was black people. I hung out with black people. I worship with black people. I ball with black people. I chill with black people. My high school basketball coach was from Grundy Center, Iowa. He went to Cornell College right up the road, right down the road, right over in Mount Vernon, Iowa. I left my all-black community in Florida for Mount Vernon, Iowa. I never thought there were so many white folks in America until I got to Iowa. Because we had sightings of white folks. Not like I'd never seen a white person, but I came to college with segregation skills. And it's taken me a while. Iowa saved my life in so many ways. I know this state has got some work. There's some real challenges still. I'm not denying that. But this is one black man that loves Iowa. This state saved my life. Gave me an opportunity to see myself much farther than I imagined myself. And it all started at Cornell, bumping up against some of that segregated mindset, that narrow mindset that I brought to college with me. So it's not just white folks. I just want to be clear. Everybody. Can y'all say that for me one time?
Everybody.
I'm going to have to work on it. I like that effort, though, bro. I appreciate that. Always like the students that participate in the class. Give you a couple extra credit points there. I appreciate that. Everybody got work to do. Everybody. You feel me?
Everybody.
Everybody. All right? Which is my second point. Knowing that we all got work to do, can you be a racist and not even know it? Is that possible? Could you be biased and you don't even know it? Actually, the research shows everybody got bias. It's not if you're biased. The question is, where is your bias? So as we see this change and we acknowledge that it's not just enough to have the presence of diversity, that we got to have diversity working. We got to have diversity in participation and collaboration. And part of the challenge of that is the segregation, the narrow mindset that all of us bring, the bias work that we all have to do. That's the second thing. Everybody's got work to do. Now, there are tests now that can tell you just how sick you are. They can identify your bias and just how strong it is. I think every university, particularly one leading the state in diversity, should require an implicit bias test. Not to penalize, but just to say, hey, I got work to do. Here's where I need to do the work. Here's how I do that work. Something to consider. Third thing is, you got to do work beyond diversity kumbaya. I mean, it's like any area in the curriculum. You can't just do addition, math 101. Eventually, you got to work your way up. And again, whatever your subject matter is, whether it's education, whether it's STEM, I mean, nobody stays. I mean, imagine being in your senior year and you're still in Spanish 101. I think I'd want a refund from the university. All right? There's got to be some progress. There's got to be some effort on your part to move along. You can't be in the same course over 4 years. All right? Diversity works the same way. We can't just be saying, kumbaya, can we all get along? Now, some people, maybe that's what you want to say, but I think, and I encourage, just like not everybody takes calculus. All right? I get it. Not everybody's ready for the highest level of English. I get it. All right? That's fine, but we should at least be offering some opportunities to grapple with tough diversity topics. All right? That's the third thing. We got to go beyond diversity 101. We got to talk about issues like privilege and power. Now, if some of y'all come from neighborhoods like I come from, you're going to go back to those neighborhoods after you graduate. You're going to be at a different place. And guess what? You're going to keep going. Right? It takes some real understanding on how to be rise, how to be improving, how to be expanding your worth. Take advantage of your college education, whether you continue on to advance your education, whether you get a raise at your job, whether you do some investing or, you know, buy some properties, right? You're going to keep going. That makes sense? You got to be understanding how power, having privilege, having power is not a bad thing. You can actually do some good things with it. That's what I'm advocating for. It's not understanding power and privilege to say, oh, white guy, you're the evil. You're the reason things are so bad. That's ridiculous. I am saying if we go to some places, there are some places the response may be different to y'all than it is to me. If we can understand that, we can do some good stuff with that. And if it's the four of us, we got to know sometimes if we say something as opposed to you saying something, it's going to be received differently. And you might be the smartest one. Probably is. But we understand that dynamic. You feel me? So it's a real commitment to understand beyond diversity, can we all get along, but to understand power, privilege. That's real skill as well. Two more things. I learned this in Iowa. The best friend that hate has is silence. I mean, I love me some Iowa. I've already done my Iowa confession, y'all. I love it. Love it. But if there's one frustration I have with the people of Iowa, good people, good hearts, but man, are they quiet. I remember I got on a plane some of the first early days of me flying out of Cedar Rapids, getting my first big airplane gig, you know what I'm saying? And I was getting on a plane and there was a dad, he was probably 30-something with his little kid who's probably 5, 6. The kid sees me coming down the aisle and the kid says to the dad, hey dad, look, there's a black guy. What does the dad say to the kid? What does he say? Oh, yes, right? It really taught me a lot about how people were conditioned into sometimes, the dad wasn't saying, you know, racist, white supremacist stuff. He wasn't doing any kind of negative. He was just saying, shh. And it reminded me how so many people get conditioned into silence. If I'm a racist, if I'm a sexist, if I'm a homophobic person, the best person I want working for me is quiet. Don't let that be you. All right? One of the things we need over the next 25 years is voice. And many of you are coming from places and spaces where you may be the one person to speak for the folks in your neighborhood. Voice is important. If you can practice anything from here on out moving forward, say something. The best friend that hate has is silence. Don't let that be you. Last thing I'll say, which is actually a question to you. Are you optimistic about the future? Y'all optimistic about the next 25 years? You optimistic?
About what?
Things gonna get better? Around MLK, social justice, diversity, the work that MLK was all about. That's what we're talking about. You feeling better about the future? I'm just saying, if y'all were convincing me in a room, I don't know. I don't know. I mean, I think it's a serious question for us to be contemplating. I mean, are you optimistic? Are you pessimistic? Do you think things are going to get worse? Well, I'm not optimistic. I'm not pessimistic either. I mean, I'm 28 years clean and sober now, so I'm really living a second chance, you know what I'm saying? So it's hard when you recover from crack and alcohol to be a pessimistic person, you know what I'm saying? Just waking up. Woo! Brother, like, I got another day, let's go. I'm happy every day. All right, so I'm not pessimistic. I don't roll like that, but I'm also not optimistic. I just read something in New York. Sister standing, waiting on the train. Asian, Pacific Islander sister, waiting on the train. Somebody pushes her in front of the train. They think it's going to be a hate crime related, anti-Asian hate, live right there in New York City. Just a couple days ago. And I see something like that and I think, I don't know. Just hard for me to be, you know what I'm saying, optimistic after reading that. That's all I'm saying. So I'm not optimistic. I'm not pessimistic. I had to come up with a new word. I'm what I call pistomistic. Pistomistic means you're optimistic. You think things are going to get better. Well, let me say it this way. It's a real privilege to think things are going to get better and not do anything. That's real privilege. That you actually believe things are going to get better, but you're not making any effort to move in that direction. That's real luxury there. Pistomistic means you're optimistic, but you're doing shizzle. You're putting some work in. And all I'm asking people to do is one thing a day. Now, if you need some motivation, let this little girl be your motivation. Now, I know some of you may be dealing with some difficult things in reference to racism and homophobia and anti-whatever. I'm not denying that, but I mean, this is my inspiration right here, this little girl right here. Yep, now, I don't know, I'm still trying to find, I want to meet Ruby, because she's still relatively young, you know. She's not an old person. This is not something that happened many, 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 many moons ago. So she's like 60-something years old, relatively young. Y'all probably know somebody 60-something years old, right? I mean, think about this. They said that when she got home from school, that her dress was literally filled with spit, that her mom could wring it out, enduring the gauntlet that she endured. Now, I'm thinking, this baby girl facing that every day? Yeah, I'm ready. Now is our time, our Ruby Bridges moment. And I'm asking you, I'm just asking people one thing a day. Can you do one thing a day? That's all I'm asking. For justice, for equity, for MLK. I've listed some books here. If you email me, I'll include those in there. And one thing a day for MLK. Today counts. Today counts. And this is a robust effort today. I mean, you're here for hours. I'm asking for like the time it takes you to get dressed. 3-5 minutes, one thing a day. If that's something you're interested in, you can see, you can contact me, and I'll be happy to share with you our, what we call our 21-day action plan that really helps people to do one thing a day for justice, for equity. My time is up. It's 12:59, and I'm finishing on time. Every now and then, I like to drop a little rhyme, so I want to thank y'all again for spending this morning, this early afternoon here, because you could have been in many other places. I thank again the president, all the student leaders, the ambassadors for being here as well. I'm going to hang around a little bit, so if there are any questions, we can do that. Anyone want to reminisce about the Iowa days. There's always somebody here from Iowa that I didn't remember or I had in my life. So if there's any of you out there, let's talk Iowa for sure. Jan, appreciate you being here. Thank y'all again. Have a great day. It's a day on, not a day off. And thank you for spending a part of that day here with me. With that, I'm going to wish you peace, wish you love, wish you soul. Take care. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
To invite you to join us for a brief reception.